God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the gift of this Easter Sunday. We thank you so much that you have made it possible for us to come. You have taught us over the past year never to take anything for granted. Thank you for gathering us this Easter as a faith community to worship you, to sing our hearts out to you who died and rose again. Lord God Almighty, we stand in awe of your power. There is nothing you cannot do. All things are possible with you. We marvel at the way you turn things around. Even when many thought that Jesus was finished, Lord, you brought him from the dead. Lord, we ask this morning that you'll open our eyes, the eyes of our hearts, to your greatness, that we may know your power. Lord, many of us know it with our minds. Help us to know it in our hearts, so that our convictions, our very convictions, will be that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or imagine. Bless this time as we share your word together and minister to us. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Christ is risen. The response is, he's risen indeed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Can we make it louder? Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed, hallelujah. A very good morning to you all. Thank you for choosing to worship with us on this Easter Sunday. We really appreciate you when you come. I was just thinking that a year ago, it was just a few of us. I don't know how many we were that day, maybe four, maybe five. And we're just seated here looking at empty chairs and trying to speak to you through the camera, but that God has gathered us today. Blessed be his holy name. Amen. Our theme this morning is the resurrection of Christ makes miracles plausible and believable. The resurrection of Christ makes miracles plausible and believable. We will base a sharing on the passage read for us out of Mark chapter 16, verse 1 to 8. That story about the women going to the tomb and what they found. But first, let me say that to believe in God, as revealed in the Bible, is also to believe in miracles. The Bible narrative begins with a miracle. That is, the world was created out of nothing. God did not need raw materials, and God did not use any raw materials. And as you continue to follow the Bible narrative, you find a woman at the age of 90 years conceiving. And God is revealing himself as the miracle-working God. But it's not only in the Bible, but the truth is that every one of us is a miracle. Think about it and let it sink in. We have four children between I and Tamar, my wife. It's amazing how each of these children are different. How as they continue to grow, their uniqueness continues to be revealed. That is a miracle. But in reality, many people, even believers, live without making room for miracles in life. While we pray to the Almighty, that is to the one with whom all things are possible, we accommodate the fact that there are things God cannot handle. And so our faith in God is the kind that places limits on God. In the resurrection of Jesus Christ, God stepped into our natural realm and did what only God can do. Hallelujah. There are four things that will guide our reflection on this theme. Number one, we look at the miracle of the empty tomb. The miracle of the empty tomb. And if you will, turn your Bibles to that passage, Mark chapter 16, verse 1 to 8, and keep your eyes in there. Possibly God the Holy Spirit will bring that story alive to you even as we share. What happens when dead people are buried? At best, they stay dead or they decompose. Their bones remain where they have been buried. That's what these women expected to find that morning as they climbed up to the tomb on the first day. These were women who were close in friendship to Jesus and in his earthly ministry. They had, in fact, supported him. When Jesus was being crucified, as Jesus was crying out and giving up his life, these are women who witnessed his death. The Gospel of Matthew records that for us. In Matthew 27, verse 55 to 56, it says there were also many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him, among whom were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. So these are women who had seen Jesus die. They knew he had died. Their plan as they go to the tomb was to do that which Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea probably never did. Because it's these two gentlemen who had asked Pilate to allow them take the body and give it a decent burial. These women, as they go to the tomb, they had the usual picture of what is expected of tombs. The stone will be in its place. We will need someone to roll the stone away because it's a big stone. And then we will embalm the body. To their amazement, the stone had been rolled away. Who did this? Why did they do this? They continue to walk into the tomb, only to find a young man dressed in white, seated in the tomb. The Bible records on the right side. Friends, this is unusual. This is not what they expected. What would you do if you took a trip to your village home, to Katakwi, to check on the grave of your grandmother, and you found that grave opened up with a young man taking a nap in the grave? What would you do? This is the kind of picture, this is the kind of sight these women are confronted with. The man dressed in white says, "You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth. He is not here. He is risen. He is not here. He is risen." But I want to invite you to think about their emotions, to think about what happens to them when they experience all this as recorded in Mark 16. The Bible tells us they left trembling. They left bewildered. They left afraid. It was too much for them to take it. It was a miracle. Their minds and emotions had not prepared them to handle such a thing. Friends, that is what Easter is about. Easter is about a miracle which God did in raising Jesus Christ from the dead. Hallelujah. But because we live in this world dominated by a materialistic worldview, in which human reason has often been exalted above faith, we too struggle. May the Lord give us faith to allow for divine intervention. May the Lord give us faith and help us recapture the wonder of divine interventions even in our lives. God is a miracle working God. The second point I would speak into are things we hear. Again, coming from this materialistic worldview, there are many books written today which say that actually Jesus never rose from the dead. There are many voices among the intellectuals which question the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so today, some atheists and neo-atheists posit that Jesus never rose from the dead. Some suggest his body was stolen. That is not new. It's even there in the Gospel of Matthew. Some say he actually never died. And so what you call resurrection was a resuscitation from a coma. How do believers respond in the age of aggressive intellectual skepticism? Even as people like Richard Dawkins posit, he says, the virgin birth, the resurrection, the raising of Lazarus, even the Old Testament miracles, all are freely used for religious propaganda. And they are very effective with an audience of the unsophisticated and children. Do you hear what he's saying? He's saying that to believe in the resurrection means you're not applying your brains, means that you are lacking in intellectual capacity, means that you are not exposed enough. But friends, that is not the case. There is reasonable ground to affirm and assert the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And there are few things I'll run through very quickly to help anyone who may be struggling because of what we read and what we watch. First, truly the tomb was empty. The tomb was empty. If the body had been stolen, the opposers to the gospel message would have produced the body and would have silenced the disciples. And on that point also, friends, it's important for us believers to know that the record for the resurrection of Jesus is not only found in the Bible, but also other writers of history in the year 2000, in the year 400, who were not necessarily Christians, affirm the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the empty tomb. The tomb was truly empty. Secondly, as we have read in the episode reading, there were eyewitnesses who saw Jesus after he rose from the dead. There are people who saw Jesus after he rose from the dead. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 talks of 500 people seeing him at the same time. Many people seeing him over a period of 40 days. Again, opposers to the resurrection will suggest probably they were hallucinating. But we know that 500 people cannot hallucinate about the same thing at the same time. And so indeed, Jesus rose from the dead. There is evidence because there are eyewitnesses. The third reason, which I find very, very powerful for my faith personally, as Paul was one, is the way the apostles continue to stand their ground that Jesus rose from the dead. As we follow their lives, it was not an easy thing to assert that Jesus rose from the dead. They were persecuted for it. They were flogged for it. They were denied the comforts of life. 10 of them died as martyrs, but they were not willing to yield or to change their message. Now, if it had been a lie, it would have been very difficult for them to continue proclaiming the same message. But that they could stand their ground and declare that God raised Christ from the dead, it means that the resurrection actually happened. Hallelujah. The last point has to do with the impact of the gospel message, and that is the growth of the church, the change in the lives of people, the change that happened to me, you know, coming from the fact that we believe in a living Savior. I think that cannot be, you know,
cannot be taken to be a lie. The impact of the church and the growth of the church globally is another testimony to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. According to Acts chapter 2, we read that God vindicated Jesus Christ by raising him from the dead so that we may have eternal life. The evangelist John puts it this way. In John chapter 20, verse 30 and 31, he says, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, that Jesus is the Anointed One, that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." So I pray that even as we read the Gospel of Mark this morning, we will believe that indeed Jesus is the Christ and continue to establish our faith on him because he's alive. Number three, reflection on the resurrection of Christ revitalizes our faith. Reflection on the resurrection of the Christ revitalizes our faith. The challenge we have, friends, is that sometimes we move through life so quickly. And this Easter could come and go so quickly. This service will end in the next couple of minutes so quickly. And we don't get a chance to stop and allow that which God has done sink in. But if we will allow to reflect on the resurrection of Christ, your faith level will not remain the same. Apostle Peter puts it this way in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. He says, "Praise God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is good, and by raising Jesus from death, he has given us new life and a hope that lives on." He has given us new life and a hope that lives on. By raising Jesus from the dead, he has given us new life and a hope that lives on. May this Easter be a springboard for our faith level to rise, that those who had lost their faith will recapture their faith. May God help us see what we have not seen in the recent past. May God help us see that God can save the unsavable, that the miracle of regeneration truly happens, that people can be born again. We were preaching the gospel in Ngora. The year was 2006. I was with Canon Geoffrey Biarugaba, and we staged a very, very simple open-air meeting. There was no platform. We just put up sound systems and started preaching the gospel. And then when the invitation for people to get saved was made, many children came and a few adult people. But one of them was a very drunk, skinny man. His skin was yellow, his eyes were red, and he came to Jesus. I had given the invitation, but I didn't have the faith that this drunkard was actually getting saved. Anyway, I did what evangelists do. They lead such people through a sinner's prayer. The next morning at 10 a.m., this man phoned us where we are staying in a team meeting. And he said to us, "When I gave my life to Jesus last night, people thought it was waraji in my brains. But I've come to tell you, Jesus saved me last night." We finished that mission maybe 3-4 days and came back to Kampala. A few months later, I was writing a mission report. And the Lord impressed it on me to call Ngora to ask about that man. And I was told that he was now an usher in the church. Amen. He was the one arranging the seats and cleaning up the sanctuary, because indeed the miracle of regeneration had happened. May God give us faith to know God can save, that nobody in our lives, nobody in our families, nobody among our peers is beyond the power
of God's grace.
May God give us the faith that He can heal all manner of pain, especially emotional pain, some of which we have carried for years, some of which defines who we are and how we approach life. But because He rose Jesus from the dead, He can root out, that pain and free us from the loads and burdens we have carried. That God will give us faith that He can heal a broken marriage, that He can restore a broken marriage. Even when people have been apart for 7 years, that God can bring that marriage together. That God can help us accomplish big things for God. Our dream as a chapel, as we go forward, is to build a sanctuary. And that God can use us to build that sanctuary in record time, because the one who rose Jesus from the dead is our God. That God will help us know that He can deal with all the impossibilities of life. Let me close by bringing the fourth point, which is really an application. And this is the application I'm inviting you to. Let us call on Christ with the confidence that we are calling on one who lives forever. Let us call on Christ in our different circumstances, whatever our needs may be, with the confidence that we are calling on one who lives forever. Listen to this conversation between him and John in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 17 and 18. It says, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet like a dead man. He laid his right hand on me and said, 'Don't be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, but look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades.'" He says, "I was dead, but look, I'm alive forever and ever. I hold the keys of death and Hades." So we come to one who is alive. We come to one who hears us when we call. We come to one who understands what we go through. We come to one who has defeated the worst of battles in human life, and that is death. Let us call on him, knowing that he lives forever. So call on him when all hope is gone. Call on him when the chains of sin are holding you down so tight. Call on him when you are struggling with depression. Call on him when your life is in physical danger. Call on him when you are drowning in debt. Call upon him to save you, because he is alive and is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we can ask or even imagine. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, we praise you. We worship and glorify your name. We exalt you who was, who is, and who is to come. We praise you, Lamb upon the throne. Jesus, our Savior. Jesus, the one we celebrate on this Resurrection Day. We come to you as a church gathering, but also as individuals. We come to you aware of our own struggles. Lord, we believe. Please help our unbelief. Lord, we believe. Please help our unbelief. We ask that in light of the resurrection, you'll cause faith to arise. I pray now that this day will be a beginning of multiplied miracles in our community as people put their faith in a risen Savior. Take us back to those things we have long abandoned to pray about. Let the resurrection of Jesus from the dead show us possibilities in God.
that with God all things are possible. May you glorify your name and may you glorify your word. For this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. May the Lord bless you.